Good evening, everyone. My name is Caroline Baumann, and I am the acting director at Smithsonian's Cooper-Hewitt National Design Museum. We opened this space just last May, the Cooper-Hewitt Design Center, to house all of Cooper-Hewitt's education programs, as our main campus on East 91st Street is undergoing a massive renovation. Knock on wood, but we hope to reopen in October of 2014, and we'll reopen with 60% more exhibition space, better circulation of public and back-of-house space, and a whole new visitor experience, unique to the nation's design museum. Let me show you a shot of that. Actually, our future third floor with the zippy car. We've welcomed just over 10,000 attendees here at the center. We thank Target for helping to make this center a reality, and we thank our high school students who designed the layout and the decoration of this space with Todd Oldham. Tonight's conversation with Clive Wilkinson is part of an ongoing series started by the late Bill Moggridge, Cooper-Hewitt's former director, who passed away last year. They are a way to promote dialogue about current issues in design and a chance for us to highlight some great practitioners working in various fields of design today. Past participants in the series include Robert Wong of Google, Chad Hurley, co-founder of YouTube, and many other luminaries. We are grateful to the Adobe Foundation for making the series possible. Those of you who knew Bill understand that these talks reflect Bill's curiosity about design and how designers work. Bill set these up so that the designer can present his or her way of thinking and working. In the same vein, Clive will present, followed by a conversation with me and Rosemary Ryan of Co., and will conclude with questions from you. Clive is an architect, designer, writer, and strategist with particular expertise in the application of urban design thinking to interior design, specifically in workplace and educational communities. His firm, based in LA, collaborates with clients to design and build creative communities. The New York Times described Clive as the South African architect of vast and groovy open plan corporate campuses. I love that. Describing TBWA Chiat Day with its streets, Central Park, and neighborhoods. The practice has completed projects across the globe for clients such as Google, Nokia, 20th Century Fox, and Disney, winning over 75 awards in the process, including, of course, the National Design Awards in Interior Design last year. Clive was inducted into the Interior Design Hall of Fame in 2005, named a Master of Design by Fast Company in 2006, and in 2011, a Pioneer of Design. Since their inception in the year 2000 as part of the White House Millennium Council, a Clinton-era initiative to celebrate innovative third millennial thinking, there has been a Washington component to the National Design Awards. The First Lady, honorary patron of the National Design Awards, oh, hang on one second. Boy, I hope they don't see that. hosts an annual luncheon following a teen design fair that the Cooper-Hewitt education team runs in the morning. This past year, the lunch was held on July 13th, the same date as Clive's second daughter's birth, so he had to miss it. Couldn't help but include that. Fast forward to the awards dinner. Hang on one second. Sorry, these got a little bit mixed up. Fast forward to the awards dinner this past October, Clive and I were seated next to each other, and he spent much of the dinner showing new baby pictures to me and to the New York Times editor seated on his other side. I admired that personal touch, talking about the newborn rather than his newest projects. No need to fear, however, he was able to get in enough details about his work to garner a nice piece a few days later. There she is. Tonight's event is being webcast live and filmed and will be available on our website, cooperhewitt.org. Please join me in welcoming Clive Wilkinson.
I promise not to talk about my kiddies. sorry, I've just got to exit this and... Can I show you a little movie first? Rosemary Ryan is in the front here, was a fabulous client of ours, seven, 8 years ago at J. Walter Thompson, now JWT, the large ad agency. And she was very much responsible for a massive transformation in their culture, which we were delighted to kind of assist on the architectural side with. So we're going to show a little movie, and Rose has very kindly agreed to be on the panel afterwards. I'm going to show a little movie that we made after that project was complete, and it is, so I think it's our only really large project in New York City. We're based in Los Angeles. So I'll put that, I'll launch that now. Sorry for the rather amateurish sort of screen behavior.
Thompson needed to transform their New York headquarters to meet the challenges of the new media world. Clive Wilkinson Architects were engaged to help create a complete physical, virtual, and behavioral transformation. As part of this process, JWT reframed its core vision about how it engaged with the public. Advertising would no longer focus on projecting messages to the consumer, but creating experiences which rewarded the public's time and attention. Its mission had become storytelling. To support this, the architectural concept became a thematic thread. We used the tree as a metaphor for storytelling, and extended it as the organizing form and connective tissue between the individual branches of the agency. This narrative tree links all departments. The trunk is the atrium void that connects the floors vertically above the entrance hall. The branches are ovoid-shaped meeting rooms, either solid green cones or acoustically padded green tents. 16 individual tents extend the metaphor further by each being incised with the first sentence of a famous novel, leaving the reader free to extend its meaning. To promote mobility and transparency, formerly isolated divisions within JWT have been opened up and reconnected. The office floors have been stripped to their industrial core. The population of 900 people now occupies a continuously varied and collaborative workspace spread over five floors on Lexington Avenue.
I was just thinking we need a transparent screen over here, so when you're projecting, people in the street can be watching from that side too. Oops, sorry. Pardon the... I put a little slideshow together. It's not really a kind of portfolio show as much as something that talks about what we're interested in and how that finds its way into physical form, in the form of design or in the form of creating environments that hopefully allow communities, work communities primarily, function better and you know more kind of productively. So that's our kind of one-line motto: we build creative communities, which is often a great challenge because the concept of creative can vary so much, and who those communities are to start with can vary so much. But I think we see ourselves as kind of facilitators in our clients' kind of journey towards a transformation in what usually amounts to kind of not just adapting to the modern world, the contemporary world, where our means of communications have kind of gone through such a radical upheaval and transformation, but also to kind of embrace the future through all altogether new ways of working and living. So I wanted to talk about collaboration and creative space. Sorry, this is not. Starting in the past, 100 years ago or so, work was conceived of really in kind of industrial factory terms. And people were kind of seen as components in the factory process, which was kind of dehumanizing and very troubling, but it was driven by kind of powerful business needs. And indeed, there were no models at that time. There were no models for how people worked together in large kind of organized ways prior to the 19th century, really. Communities had been much smaller in doing things productively. There had been a guild system, which had been quite a sophisticated system that evolved through the Middle Ages, in Europe in particular. But the guild system also had its own kind of constraints and kind of many kind of parallels to union organization, which equally has had problems in the 20th century. And we now find ourselves in an age where you can't systematize work in this way anymore. Thank God computers are taking over the roles that these people were performing. And we're in a different kind of amorphous world where, to use this great phrase from Marshall McLuhan, who said this in, I think, 1965, we continue to use old tools to solve new problems. So we've gone through these different kinds of economies, from the agricultural one, which largely ruled the world up until about 1800, the industrial economy, which everyone's fully aware of, that ran, I think, technically to about 1920, and then the service economy, where the white-collar worker had supplanted the blue-collar worker in numerical terms, up until towards the end of the 20th century, which now is only kind of 15 years or so ago. And we're in a new kind of economy. We don't really know what the name of it is, but we can call it, for want of a name, the idea economy. Because we do feel at least that human ideas are going to drive change and will be the one reliable component in moving into the future. So we know we've gone away from paper, which since 1453 or whatever, with the birth of the Gutenberg press, became the prime vehicle for transacting business across the world. To a time where it's become increasingly redundant, and may only be a kind of an object of affection in about 10 or 15 years' time. Now, what this means is that the type of work we do can change radically. Everyone knows mobility is kind of the answer. They don't necessarily quite know why, but the why is, we were rather unnecessarily tethered to our workspace in the past because of the cumbersome nature of paper, and that we're definitely freed from now. Going back again kind of to the 12th, 13th century, this is the monk Saint Jerome studying inside this kind of hypothetical space that was the creation of the artist of the time, but is really quite wonderful because in one picture, there's a myriad of threads about where his imagination is going, the kind of underpinnings of his world, the nature of shelter, the nature of religion, the nature of symbolism. It's kind of an unbelievably rich image. And then on the right, kind of a provocative image as well. It's the first mobile office, probably one of the first mobile offices done on any big scale, Chiat Day in 1995, where they decided to dispense with people owning desks and everyone could work anywhere, which was both very liberating but also full of challenges, like no one can really work very long on a chair like that because they're going to have back problems in no time. So maybe this is a question that we might pursue as well on the panel. Why do we need to collaborate? We know that business promotes collaboration today, all advanced businesses do. It's about building community, it's about increasing speed to market, it's about solving problems faster, and it's about leveraging knowledge sharing, which very often is coming from the ground up. It's not coming top down, as senior management had preferred to see the world up until very recently. But there are also other reasons. We need friends. We need family. We're actually in a very, very fragmented moment in time in terms of our community connections. And part of that's because of our own mobility. Many of us in this room are probably hundreds and hundreds of miles away from your home. And that's a common condition today, and it wasn't a common condition even up to 50 years ago. So that last point, we need to discover and connect with our own tribes. And this is a kind of a very interesting point because in the absence of our families, we've got a very nice liberty of being able to create new families. And that's from peers around you and people that interest you. And that, I think, is also a great benefit to being able to realize your own potential and to associate with the people that you feel you get stimulation and pleasure out of. So in the workplace, we've moved from this rather rigid model of 70% individual space, and that is all of these offices with enclosed offices everywhere and a small amount of group space, to a model that's very different. It's primarily group space. It's blurred the boundaries with individual space, which is now considerably smaller. Now, we know the challenges around this kind of new model, because a lot of people feel they can't get their work done properly without a lot of distraction in the workplace. But this is still an evolving model, and we're just at one moment in time right now. What we're all looking for in business, though, is unified communities. Part of that is about having your brand, whoever you work for, your brand and your community having kind of a sort of a unity of expression. But it's definitely about having a bigger family to belong to. So what are the determinants of creative space as we understand it today? We'd like to suggest there's these six things that come into play. There's a culture model. There's a component of disruption and play, because the act of disruption definitely is one that can facilitate and generate ideas. Choice and diversity, which is super important. It's not only about the diversity in the workforce, it's diversity and choice in options about how you're going to conduct your work life. And then human scale, community and collaboration, and the city as a paradigm. I'll get into that in a second. The culture model is actually one of the most fascinating ones, which there's not enough discussion about right now. I think we've shifted from a state of maturity and sophistication, a closed system that developed over many hundreds of years, from the Greeks and the Romans literally, to a state of immaturity and naivety, which is an open system. So there's kind of positive and negative aspects to both of those. And putting these two images together tends to illustrate that. On the left, you've got Marie Antoinette, probably around the age of 19 or something, and a modern young lady of similar age. And in Marie Antoinette's dress, of course, is a very high degree of elaboration and sophistication, because this is indeed a mature model that has been refined, worked on, and played with over centuries. On the right is a model that's changing continuously, because everything about our culture in the present time is changing like that. But what's the most interesting thing about this picture? It's the fact that Marie Antoinette's got gray hair. Why she got gray hair? Power resided in age. It's really simple. We've turned that system on its head. Power resided in age. Old people called the shots in 1780, and in fact for centuries. So it was cool to appear old. Now it's very cool and very uncool to appear old. And a lot of that, in fact, goes back to the advertising world, which made a discovery back in the 50s and 60s that, I'm not sure, Rose, you know the timing better than me, that Young people hadn't made their consumer choices. Old people had. Therefore, it was pretty unnecessary to market to old people, or pointless, and it was very lucrative and smart to sell to young people, because you could actually get their attention and get their allegiance young and keep that there and sell products to them kind of indefinitely. Hence, we've got a completely different model of where power resides in our communities. It's fascinating. on the left here, I'm not sure whether it's St. Petersburg or Versailles, but it's again this highly elaborated, almost to the point of absurdity, model of European culture. And on the left, that's a very playful but strangely similar space done for Disney, the Disney store, so that they could store their the toys that they made in this honeycomb. It's a project we did about 5 years ago in Los Angeles. And a couple more shots of the workspace, which now is you know, increasingly a very open and transparent environment. Disruption and play being very important aspects to a creative workplace. I remember Jay Shiat saying, quite a legendary ad man, saying to me in the early 90s, when there was some discussion about making employees comfortable, which might have come from some of his people, and he was kind of outraged, and he said, "I don't want my people to be comfortable. I want them to be provoked, because only if they're provoked are they really going to do great work." And true then and true today. It's the same letters. So the tiniest things in your world can be adjusted and have a fantastic effect. This is the same building. The client wanted a space where all hands could kind of get together, 200 people, and without giving up that space. So we made a conference room with demountable soft block walls. And once a month they could have 200 people. And then we timed it that it took 30 minutes and two guys to reassemble the wall. So it was really easy to do. That's it's that little component there. And there those honeycombs in that back section of this warehouse conversion. Another fun kind of sort of experiment on people working together was Mother, the ad agency in London, where they all wanted to work around one large table. And when they started working on it's actually a lovely story. They started working as six people around a kitchen table when they started their business. And then as they kind of added people, they just grew the table. And when I started working with them in about 2003 or four, there were 75 people working around one really big table. It was wooden, it had kind of spread all over this very, very large room, and they said, "We want a table for 200. So we thought, this is going to be a huge challenge. It's a huge room they're giving us, 15,000 square foot room. So we need something that's going to wrap around the whole room. So we decided to take the Turin racetrack that was on the roof of the Fiat factory in the late 20s as being a really fun kind of idea and wrap that around this room. And we also broke a big staircase through from the downstairs lobby. So a 14-foot wide staircase turns into a table and then drives all the way around the room. And then we banked it up around this side so that it really would feel like a kind of a racetrack. And then made it out of concrete so that they couldn't change it too easily. And that was very much their commitment, actually, was to go. Nothing could be more ridiculous for an ephemeral business like advertising than to work on a concrete table like that. And curiously, 8 years later, it's actually still exactly the same. This is actually a photograph taken on a Sunday, so it's not full of people, but you can kind of see that where it ramps up in the end. And I think they kind of occasionally have fashion shows and things like that down it. And these types of spaces are really quite wonderful because everyone has, you know, everyone is mobile with laptops and cell phones, and they can work around the table. And when they want to work in teams, they simply hive off, and there's breakout areas all the way around the perimeter. So it's quite an efficient work model and very, very kind of community focused. Fluidity and free space, movement and flow through buildings and through businesses is incredibly important. And the ability to flex space as well. This is Google on the left over here, and that's the thing that we really hate on the right. We hope we never ever have to build a corridor. I think we don't think we have built one yet, really. In the late 90s, we also discovered this really interesting statistic about office use. People who occupy their desks doing different tasks through the day, DGW, the workplace strategist, had kind of done this study of a number of businesses, and there's kind of meeting and computers and telephones and talking and reading and writing and et cetera, et cetera. And the thing that emerged that was really fascinating was that for this massive portion of the day, people weren't at their desks in businesses. Now, the workspace hadn't kind of accommodated that movement, free flow at all at that time. I mean, this was a typical building over here with a corridor that ran around the perimeter, or perimeter offices everywhere, kind of inboard sort of secretarial stations, and that was a typical office building. That was referred to as the kind of the racetrack around the space. So at that time, we started really investigating the capability of internal circulation areas as being something much richer and much more susceptible to new thinking and kind of reprogramming about how they're used. So here, actually, since I've showed the movie, I'll flick through these because these are slides of Rose's JWT. Just to give an idea of the scale, these are the massive floor plates over here. It's 250,000 square foot, and it was built in phases with people in occupation at the time. Number four, choice and diversity. This slide is actually one we've now found ourselves using with so many clients. It's like you have a desk, and everyone's just given a desk or a cubicle, and they might have an office, and you want to get them out of the office, and you don't really have a conversation about much beyond the desk. But that's a really thin way of looking at the world. Your people do tasks that have a great variety how they kind of unravel. They're collaborating with people, one-on-one sometimes, in very small groups, in much larger groups, in much more complex groups, and there's no kind of architecture to support that. So this is actually a slide we used when we worked on Nokia in their headquarters in Finland, and suggested that they could have this kind of variety in place of this. And that phrase actually we used, which came from their advertising their smartphones. So we said, well, you know, your smartphones are talking about multi-platform opportunities, but your workspace isn't. And why are these things not the same, going down the same paths? And we had a similar thing experience with Google. We master planned their campus in Mountain View, Silicon Valley, in 2005. And this somewhat crazy kind of model over here was the master plan. The buildings were slightly crazy. Buildings, too, actually were pre-existing. They were Silicon Graphics, the computer company that slowly went under because they were all about big power, and then eventually the power of ordinary PCs kind of crept up and overtook them. So in planning the campus, we came up with a whole range of work settings in discussion with them. These are the two floors of the building. There are 13 in total. And what's illustrated in the plan here, the orangey-red areas, is kind of a thermal diagram of noise within the campus, because we felt it was important to actually plot the sort of sound contours of the space so that we could be in control about the areas where people needed to do very, very focused code writing, and then the areas where people were collaborating and relaxing and hanging out. This is a typical work room that was developed at that time, which let light and views right through into the space, and then had these custom tent ceilings to absorb sound within those spaces because there were so many hard areas that were glass. And that's a typical view of the street in Google. And elements of the previous build-out were reused as well. I mean, these doors and windows over here are all reused from the previous tenants. And they have this sort of slightly ironic expression of doors kind of going to nowhere on that upper level. This is an exercise we started with one client, which is very useful. It's taught to look at the day in the life of people doing different types of work, and then running through a day and seeing what sort of story that starts to tell you about how the work environment really ought to work. And again, supports that that notion of offering variety in a strategic way. We did this this project for activity-based working. I won't go into the detail of activity-based working, but it is a form of mobile working which is highly supported by specific designed work settings. This project was done for 3,000 people in Sydney for a bank, a financial institution, and they felt it was worth kind of engaging the future and taking a big risk with basically going to mobile working where everyone had a desk in their existing situation. They went through a smart change management process and piloted a floor with these different types of work settings, and in the end, by the time people moved into the building, there was a conversation that had been going through the company about this type of change. And it got a massive approval rating from the staff, 96% thumbs up after 3 months of being in the space. There were sort of some smart moves, like there are 100-person neighborhoods that are configured across the building. There are hubs that provide certain types of services. But there's all sorts of work settings for kind of one, two, or more people to be doing different things. It's 6 years on, and it's still a very successful experiment. And it's now been copied, actually, in many large companies in Australia because it's been kind of very visibly successful in that market. This is the atrium space where we were lucky enough to be able to actually configure meeting rooms through the atrium. So there's a sort of a collaboration on display. And typical work areas, and also had this fantastic offered this fantastic opportunity that clients could enter into their business and be hosted in these meeting rooms that were hanging out inside this atrium, get incredible views into the bank's business without ever breaching security, because you couldn't actually read what was written on anyone's screen. The distances were just separated enough. So number five, human scale, community and collaboration. Actually, I think I'm talking too long. So human scale, community and collaboration, manageable groups or tribes, neighborhoods and interaction. I'll try and speed up a little bit. Curious thing that's so obvious in a way that we realized fairly early on, large organizations have big sociological challenges, big sociological problems, because they have such a tendency to alienate people. It's very difficult for large businesses to kind of become big families. Small businesses is a very different situation. Kind of anything under 40, 50 people, everyone knows everyone else. There's a kind of a network of trust, a kind of bonds that go through people, and they don't really need much help from their work environment. They'll kind of that's a super flexible model. So our challenges really reside in large corporations. Back in the 90s, we observed with Wired magazine's first offices in San Francisco that there was this fantastic flexibility with desks and kind of mess everywhere. But at the same time, people who were working in different groups were finding it quite hard to not be distracted or disturbed by their neighbors, because there was no architecture to the space. The answer wasn't to separate everyone else apart from each other, but to actually do a combination of separating and blending so that neighborhoods could flow into each other. And this became a model in terms of our planning that we felt was one to consistently take into the future. This is the plan of Shiat Day in Los Angeles, which we did at that time, where every neighborhood flows into every other neighborhood, which means that groups can expand and contract with a great deal of flexibility. That's a a shot of Shire Day, one of the neighborhoods, and they have project room tents. Another shot of Shire Day. Then finally, the city as a paradigm. There are artifacts about the city, and there's a kind of a built-in collective memory about the city, which makes the idea of using city concepts and taking them into the workplace seem very natural. And so we do that quite a lot these days. We believe, you know, right from the time of, you know, medieval towns, all of the concepts that we talk about that are kind of collectively shared and discussed amongst our clients, these are not exclusively designer concepts by any means. They're actually come more from our clients. They're all in that network of the city that has grown up through history. And finally, this is the same Australian client's bank in London, where we broke through six floors of office space, which they leased. So it was quite a brave move to go and lease expensive London city space and then break a big hole through it all and put a connecting stair, because they felt it was so important that the different parts of their communities were joined together very visibly, very powerfully. And it's also, that's been a fantastic success too. I remember in the first sort of month of being there, I actually was down on the ground floor and I saw an IT group of about 17, 18 people walk all the way up the staircase, go and have a meeting in this room at the top, and then at the end of the meeting, an hour or so later, walk all the way down the staircase, and they didn't use the lift. And they all seemed to just be doing it naturally. So you kind of know that you've built in a kind of a healthy connection thing that gets away from kind of the negative aspects of elevators, and it works. A couple of more images of that bank. That's the view down of the staircase. So thank you very much. Sorry if I went along on a bit too long.
We'll introduce Rosemary and then we'll take a seat. Rosemary Ryan has a terrific title that I need to share with you, which is co-founder and co-CEO of Co. Story-led innovation collective designed to ready brands and businesses for growth in the networked world. Before founding Co., Rosemary was co-president of JWT North America and has worked at BBDO, Shire Day, and Kirschenbaum & Bond, where she was president. Rosemary has been instrumental in positioning and building world-class brands for JetBlue, J&J, Johnson & Johnson, De Beers, and Bing for Microsoft. Please join me in welcoming Rosemary Ryan. Is this still working?
I think.
No, this is fine. This is for you.
Oops.
That's great. I'll take this one. Is it working? Yes. Well, I would love to kick this off. Thank you so much, Clive. That was fascinating. Cool. Wonderful. I'd love to kick this off and talk about your relationship and when you met. You were president of JWT, and Clive had discussed the change with me a bit and said it takes a smart leader to embrace the kind of change that you welcomed by hiring Clive and making all the changes that you did. And personally, I'd love to know also about the conflict. You talked about approvals from the staff. How did that whole process work? And was there dissent? How did it all unroll?
So I arrived at JWT in 2004, the beginning of 2004, and to be honest, I had never actually walked into the agency before I had accepted the job, so I had no idea just how awful it was. I'd never walked in. Because I was, you know, the conflicts were such that if anyone saw me there, they'd know that that's probably what I was doing. And it was probably one of the most horrific experiences I've ever had, because I was lucky enough to grow up at Shire Day. So I worked for Jay in 1989, 1990, 91. And I'd only ever worked in kind of open plan, collaborative environments. I worked for small, creative, and quite large companies who really prided themselves on the culture that they'd built and the work that they did. And I got to JWT, and it was a venerable agency. It was huge. As you remember, those four floors, there were about, I don't know, 1,000 people there. And there were lots of long corridors, lots of, it was a terrible building, lots of offices. I was escorted to my corner office. and given a book of furniture to choose and some paintings that I could get out of the archives. And so the first thing I said was, is it possible for me to kind of take the doors off? Because I feel so lonely. And I was on the creative floor. I'd never felt so isolated and lonely in my life. And they didn't want me to take the doors off. So I brought my own screwdriver in, and eventually the doors came down. And, I quickly came to realize that, I mean, there were one or two spaces that were kind of okay, that you wouldn't be embarrassed to take your clients to. But it was not an environment that was conducive to creativity or collaboration or any of the things that are necessary to get the kind of work done that we need to get done. And so the space symbolized everything that needed to change. It was a very hierarchical organization, very siloed organization, so everybody like worked in their own departments, had their own floors. The senior people sat in offices, the more junior people sat outside offices. There were very few meeting spaces, and the spaces that were there were either for client presentations or one or two breakout spaces, but they were like windowless, not places where you'd actually want to go and spend time. Carpet was awful. I mean, just everything about it was bad. And I realized that in order to, to bring about the kind of change that they'd asked me to bring about, that I actually had to start with the space, because it was just impossible to be felt or heard. I mean, we talk about storytelling. I think we actually believe in story doing. So, in order for you to create something awesome, you've got to be in an environment where that's kind of possible. So everything about the current agency said the wrong thing. So I was lucky enough, they told me, because I was going to kill myself, they said, it's okay, we've got some money, the lease is coming up, we can make some big changes. Anyway, it transpired that we couldn't move out of the building, or that would have been my first choice. And so therefore I needed something pretty transformative to even have a chance, I believe, of creating the kind of change that they asked me to make. And I don't say that lightly. I think that the environment that you work in, the design of the environment, I think shapes the kind of work that you do. So it was fundamental, and I was introduced to a number of big design architectural companies who were lovely, and they presented, and I'm used to presenting to clients, and they presented their ideas to me, but nobody actually asked me what kind of culture I was trying to create and what I wanted to do. And someone said, I know this guy called Clive Wilkinson, and I'm not sure WPP are going to be so comfortable with him, but I'm going to get him in here. And it was like, it was the most, I think, the best thing that happened to me when I was there. So Clive came in, he had no presentation, he brought a little kid robot thing in with him. And he sat down and said, so what is it you're trying to do here? What do you want to do? And so we spent like an hour and a half talking about, the kind of philosophy, the culture that I wanted to create, how hard that was going to be, the restrictions in terms of money and the usual stuff. And he walked away and gave me some hope that actually maybe we could do something. So he never presented a plan or anything. We just decided that we were going to work together. You remember the kid? I've still got the kid robot.
Do you?
Yeah, the little rabbit thing.
Lit. We have actually quite often given clients something very childish and to see the reaction, and it's usually incredibly effective.
Always.
So, if you're thinking toys. Well, it was a dream for us. I mean, what an amazing... It was a dreadful space, but it was really was an organization with fantastic kind of history in many ways. And a lot of us don't kind of go back that far with a lot of businesses. But JWT like had a TV studio in the 70s in the building. They broadcasted their own TV shows. I mean, so as an agency who'd kind of gone like this and had been at some point in time extremely powerful and got massive percentages on their campaigns and stuff, like the industry did at one stage.
And we had great people, but they were all isolated from each other.
So how long did the process take?
2 years?
Well, it took quite a while. It was quite efficient, except that we had the challenge that they had to stay in place while we were building. So it was pretty disruptive. We did a floor at a time. There were four floors or four and a half floors.
Yeah.
So people had to live through quite a lot of...
But I think that was a blessing, because everyone was used to having their own offices. And I mean, people used to count how many ceiling tiles they had. because that would tell you kind of like how important you were. And so when I told them they all had to kind of move out of their offices, they were like freaked out. So, you know, people had to move in with each other because there was no other option. So we started putting two or three people together in an office. We started taking people's doors off. People were furious that their doors were taken off. And then they started getting worried about the fact because, you know, everything is symbolic. If their door hadn't been taken off, what did that really mean about them and their future at JWT? So it was amazing to... So putting people together, forcing them to live together in, like, kind of tight quarters, I think really helped them understand just how great it is to actually share a space with someone and what that feels like when you go to work every morning.
I think you can kind of tell from what Rose is saying is the real cultural transformation is taking place from the top leadership. It's not a case of architects doing something cool. It's a massive internal cultural transformation. And it takes fantastic leaders to author that.
Mm-hmm. How quickly did that evolve? There was fear, there was worry about losing your office, but how quickly did you see creativity and improvement sort of take over?
I mean, very fast, actually, because we were doing it floor by floor, the people who were the first people to inhabit the kind of first floor, and we had mixed everybody up, so there weren't the creative department and the account management department, so everyone was mixed up. They started to just be happier at work, and so everybody wanted to be where they were. And their clients actually started coming to the agency more because it was a place that they actually wanted to hang out in. And so it was great for the people who worked there, it was great for the client people we worked with, and in the end, people were just getting impatient about, okay, when is this bloody thing going to be finished so I can like work in a space like that too. The agency was really transformed over those 5 years, and I would say that the moment I remember most is when Microsoft walked into the agency and they just happened to be in town, and someone said you should go and see JWT, and they're like, yeah, they're kind of big and they're global, but I think they're kind of quite conservative. And they walked into our new space, and they were just completely blown away. And so I think it opened their mind to who we were and the kind of work that we could do with them. And then JetBlue, which was the first big account we won, they came in as we were actually knocking through the first floor. So we walked them through the new space and the transformation that we were going through. And that kind of gave them an idea of the kind of company we were and the kind of work that we could do. So it was amazing.
So your current role as head of Co, there it's a much smaller family or community of 35 people. Did you take some of the things you learned at JWT and that massive change and import it to your new...
Yeah, I mean, I think that a lot of the things that I learned, as I said, I think I learned from Jay Shire. So I had like lived in amazing, I'd worked in, actually lived, to be truthful, because if you worked at Shire Day, you lived and worked there. But I had lived in those kinds of spaces, and so... You know, working with Clive, because we just were simpatico immediately, we kind of knew what we wanted to do together. And in my new space, I mean, it's kind of taken the whole collaboration model to a new level. So we work with lots of other companies as well. We're a collective. So we have a kind of, we're at the hub, and then we bring other people and companies in to work with us. So we have to have a space that has those kinds of environments in it. So there's a lot of writable walls. There's very few presentations that actually happen. We kind of build collages and we believe in being able to rip stuff down and put new stuff up together. So we've designed the space around the kind of work that we need to do on a slightly different budget than we had at JWT. But but we actually put a fair amount of money into it. I mean, we decided that that was critical because if you spend the money on the right things and people love coming to the space, then you'll do better work.
Your home and your office are kind of equally important. I mean,
totally.
why should your office suffer?
You know that Jay used to say that before he hired people, he wanted to go to their homes and kind of check out what they look like. It would tell him everything he needed to know.
Funny you say that, because the very first thing, I first got into this business of workplace through Jay Shire too. In 1990, I was working for Frank Gehry in Los Angeles, and Frank said, oh, I want you to be project architect for Jay's binocular building interior. So I walked into the meeting to meet Jay and a whole bunch of other people, and he turned to me and he said, before he said anything, he said, how big a house did you grow up in? So I said, what? He said, how big a house did you grow up in? And I said, well, reasonably big house. It was South Africa. It was kind of, not much different to America. I said, oh, Oh, so you didn't grow up in a little English house, did you? I don't want anyone who grew up in a little house designing my office.
Speaking of your house and your office, you mentioned to me that you're very inspired at the moment by your new space. Can you share with the group what your new space is and why you're so excited about it?
Oh, that's sweet of you. We had to move out of where we were. We're kind of in this crazy retail environment of Robertson Boulevard in West Hollywood in L.A., which is it's become like what SO has become here, you know, overwrought with fashionistas and trendies. So we wanted to get out, and we went down to Culver City, and we were just lucky enough to find a piece of ground, and that was relatively inexpensive, and it was 2009, so the market had fallen down for construction costs, and money was cheap. So we managed to work out that we could actually build our building for the same price that we were renting, which was kind of great. Now, I still don't quite know how that happened, but it did. And we built it, and it built it for the price of a house, and we moved in, and we got our big warehouse. We can't afford to furnish it, but it's really fantastic to just have a huge space. And as we were saying earlier, you don't need much if you're a manageable small organization, because you're really an extended family. Just very, very different to the large organization and all of its challenges.
What's alarming, I suppose, is the number of companies that still live in the old factory style. You know, look at Wall Street, I was inspired by the financial organizations that you show tonight in Australia and London,
yeah.
Because they're often the companies that stick with the cubicle for each employee, and hopefully that'll continue to expand so that more institutions embrace this new.
It's true. It's actually a constant fight. I mean, that is literally my day-to-day role, is going into companies and then having arguments about cubicles and things like that, and corridors and offices, and it's like you're on this little mission to transform us all into kind of an open, fun, you know, very livable environment. I mean, people have lots of built-in fears about what they're used to.
Yeah. I mean, people had a million reasons why they needed to have their office. And the only way that you can persuade them that it's actually better to live a different way is to take them out of that. And they will be uncomfortable for a few weeks, and then finally they recognize how liberating it is. I mean, I think that for me, one of the really interesting things is people are opting out of the traditional workforce. I mean, I think some people are forced out of it, but I think a lot of people are opting out, and they're moving to more of these kind of cooperative workspaces. I mean, we started one. When we started our company, we also joined forces with a couple of other people who were starting that, and we opened a thing called Grind, which has been really successful, and we're opening another one now in Chicago, and hopefully one in Los Angeles.
Cool.
And another one in New York. And it's amazing for me. There are like groups of individuals or three or four people who now that's their workspace. They own it. It's amazing to see how the community works together, how they share work with each other. It's an inspiration, actually. And I think more and more of those things are starting to pop up all over the country.
It's particularly exciting because it's kind of almost like you've created this type of space, which is a business space where people can be corporations themselves.
Yeah.
They can be entrepreneurs themselves, they can just be their own business, and they can feel like they have their own premises and capabilities.
How do you both feel about the open space versus having no office space and just coming in with your laptop and plopping down wherever you might find an open area?
So it's as interesting because in our new space, that's part of our philosophy. No one has a desk. I mean, I've always lived in an open space, but everyone just kind of sits wherever they want to sit every day. And so I think it is kind of good and it's hard. I mean, I find that most people tend to go back to the space that they were the day before. And you have to constantly remind people that actually it's really important to. So you almost have to force it. It's not something that people naturally do. But once they kind of get into the rhythm of it, it works quite well. Jay used to make us all move every 3 months in the other space. So it's not easy. I mean, that Grind is based on that. No one has a desk. You don't have a place that you own. You just come in and you sit wherever there's a space. It's not for everyone, I think. But.
Which is interesting because you talked about your office being your home. And if you don't feel like you have your nest or your niche with a few photographs and personal things, how do you deal with that?
But we've certainly tried to discourage people from having any personalization in the office. And it's not because we don't like those little photographs of your dog and stuff. It's because the office should be more of a collective family, and it's not a bunch of people with their own personal lives in kind of small little nests. So there's something wrong, to my mind, there's something wrong with your office if there's a real need to do that. It's like the office is not performing. I mean, you don't create a little corner at your home with tiny little pictures of things around you. I don't think.
I don't think so. Clive, the space at Mother is fantastic, 42,000 square feet, and you came up with this unifying element of a concrete table, inspired by this 1920s Fiat space. And I see a lot of Renaissance images, a lot of medieval images. You told me that you're inspired in the shower, but you're obviously inspired also by history. Can you talk to us a little bit about when you have a project or a challenge, how do you find inspiration?
Oh, honestly, it all begins with conversations. It all begins with listening, and I'm very conscious of the fact that we provide a service and that one should never lose sight of the fact that you're employed to help people with their issues, whatever they are. So it begins with listening, and it begins with that conversation, and it begins with the culture of your client and where they want to go and how you can help them go down that path. So it's very collaborative and interactive in that sense, and I think that's probably why Rose clicked with me, because... Yeah. I was trying to click with her, because really that's what we were doing. Now, the story of people over time is something that's just has always interested me, because there are all these kind of parallels about history. That the more you get into history, the more amazing it is to find that the mirror situations that happened many, many years ago. So that's just a kind of personal interest. But we have. We're all part of an elaborated thread that brings us up to the present, and we're just part of a thread that's continuing. And what's the role we play in elaborating that thread and making it something worthwhile and useful and a contribution to society?
One of the things that Clive did do that we brought forward into Co, which we hadn't really experienced before, is there were a lot of different kinds of workspaces. So, depending on what mode you're in, you can go to a different kind of space to get inspiration, to have a quiet conversation, to work with a big group of people. And so there are, in our new space, we've got a lot of different kinds of spaces to go and be, because I think it does put you in a different frame of mind. And I think that for me has worked incredibly well. I mean, one of the downsides sometimes of open space is it can become a bit monochromatic. Yeah. It's a bit like, and if you have a lot of different spaces to go and be in, then I think I think it opens people's minds up.
And I think human beings like journeys, and your day should be a journey. It should be that you start in one place and you move through other places and other experiences with people and on your own. And the richer that is, the greater the day you have.
And that those moments of surprise that you created everywhere are also really lovely. So you turn around a corner and then there's like a big pair of smiling lips or something, or like a question mark or a question. And I think that's also very important because it keeps it fresh.
And that I learned from Jay. It was disruption.
Yeah.
Clive, how do you dive into different projects? You've worked for Quicksilver, so the demographic there is sort of the 12 to 14-year-old hip kid. And then the Googlers that are 25-year-olds. How do you deal with that? Do you do a lot of research? How do you get into their minds?
You have to get into your inner infant.
Yeah. Sometimes. Bring the toys with you.
people connect out of curiosity with each other, I think, most of the time. So if you're very curious about who your client might be, that's all you need. It doesn't really matter. You might be a different generation. I was having a meeting with a very young kind of media company this morning, and I realized I was like double the age of all of them. but it didn't really hit me immediately. It was just after a while. I don't think it matters how old you are, quite honestly. It's they're old people, at the age of 10. It's a mentality. people are born at different... I've always thought mental age and physical age are two separate things. Mm-hmm. And there are people... Frank Gehry, who I worked for, is like 85, is a total child. in a good and bad way. You know, he has tantrums. He's got all of those things. His mental age is not the physical one. This has been broadcast live.
Yes, it is.
Speaking of age and expertise and experience, there's a lot of students in the audience tonight, and I think it'd be great if each of you could talk a little bit about how you got to where you are today, and you know, proffer any advice that you might have.
So it's interesting because I was asked this question recently, and the way that I've always answered it, which is true, is that I have always just kind of got my hair down, and I found people I love to work with, projects that I love to work on. And I've focused kind of all my energy on making those as great as I can be, as they can be. So for me, that's, I don't see a huge separation between my like work life and my home life. I mean, I think we should try as much as we possibly can to do things that we love. And I consider myself to be blessed in the fact that I can do that. And then the other way is I've always been really bossy. So, and I realized that, you know, when I was five, when I went to my first school, I sat down and I got there like 4 months after all the other kids because of when my birthday fell. And I was like, oh my God, I'm in this room of like 30 kids and I don't know any of them. So I just got all of the toys and put them on my desk and then kind of handed them out one by one, which is a horrific story. But so lovely. I think I've always been a little bit bossy. So I think that's kind of helped. But I think just passion and just loving what you do is kind of everything.
Yeah, I think listen to your own heart. You know, whatever you're curious about is really a major cue about where you should go, because you'll always do great and enjoy what you're doing if you connect with what you're doing. One of the biggest mistakes in the world out there is that an awful lot of people get jobs for accidental reasons and nothing to do with what they're really into. So it's a privilege to be able to pursue what you're really into, but you know, try and make that a business pursuit as well. You know, something that you can actually live on.
Speaking of loving your work, do you each have a project that's keeping you up at night that is just so exciting that you want to keep thinking about it?
Yeah, I mean, my project is my company because it's, you know, we're 2.5 years old. We're trying to kind of reinvent business in many regards. And I'm learning new things every day, which is incredibly, exciting and keeps me awake at night for good reasons. So I guess, you know, I have a lot of my client projects and my project is the company. So.
I think we're sort of strangely similar. We're not as new a company. We've been going for 22 years, but we're in the fourth phase of what we do. And each of those phases has had different characteristics, different people leading it and different goals. And we happen to be at the beginning of a new cycle, so it's kind of fascinating to figure out what is it that we're really going to be doing over the next 10, 12 years. Having a massive question in your life is really fun.
Yeah, I love being uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And not knowing the answer. Yeah. I don't think it's for everyone, but...
Yeah, I'm definitely driven by curiosity and the sense that... one's on a search and one hasn't got there yet and you're trying to unravel. I guess it's the little knot of civilization almost in a way that I think many people are grappling with from different perspectives.
Clive, can you talk a little bit about your training and how you sort of evolved into this expert dealing with office space?
That's part of, I believe that life is a series of forked paths and you don't often realize it, but you make choices at certain points and you go down certain paths and you end up somewhere quite different to what you originally planned. I started as I actually wanted to be a writer originally. I wanted to go to Cambridge and study literature when I was 19, but my parents couldn't afford to send me there and there wasn't anything equivalent in South Africa, so I was at a little dilemma and my sister was in architectural school and I heard all about the first year course in architecture, which was very kind of Bauhaus configured at the time, which was really interesting. Quite sort of arts driven, so I thought I'll go and do that, and I spent a year doing that and then I found that I really quite liked it and I did well at it because I didn't care about whether I passed or failed, and so that just sort of got me. So that was one forked path. It was completely accidental. I ended up in London from another forked path because of the apartheid situation in South Africa. I needed to get out of the country because I was being military drafted, and I said to my parents, I'd point the gun the other way, so they knew I'd either be in jail or dead. And so in 1976, I went to England and finished the Architectural Association, which was really a fabulous architectural school. And then after 12 years in London, I couldn't take the weather anymore because it was permanently grey, and I didn't grow up with that. So I went around the world for a year in 1989, looking at different places to live. I was attracted to Australia and lived and worked in Sydney for a while. And then I came to the States, and I came to New York, and I got job offers in New York and L.A., and the L.A. one happened to be with Frank Gehry, and it was also better money than the New York one. So I went off to L.A., and I got stuck. Worked with Frank Gehry, and before then I was doing buildings, and it was just accidental that I got this sort of job with Jay Shire at Frank Gehry's, and then when I went on my own, Shire Day kept on giving me work. That was another forked path. I didn't intend to be an interior designer. But that's fine. Life is a journey. It's fabulous.
I think you've just got to be open to whatever comes your way, and as long as you're open to it, I think great things can happen.
I agree. On that nice note, are there questions from our audience? There must be. Do you have a mic?
Hi.
I'm sorry, I couldn't quite hear. Yes, yeah, no, it is amazing, and it's kind of ongoing, and it's happening in much more advanced ways in cities like this, certainly with the creative communities in places like New York and London and Sydney, the bigger Los Angeles, bigger cities. It's probably kind of far behind in a lot of other places, but it's interesting to know where it's going to go, because you get the very strong sense that technology is going to still do things to how we work, that we're still in its kind of infancy in terms of people who are investigating the transmittive power of skin and things like this to carry information. It's just, there's a whole undiscovered world there and I think a lot of what about the change we've gone through, which we think we've done ourselves, has really been because technology liberated us.
Yeah. I think there's a new study that's just come out that IBM conducted, and I think they talked to like 200 CEOs across the world, and they've been doing the study for about, I guess, 20 years. But what they've discovered is that the cultures that used to be incredibly successful in the workplaces that were very successful were hierarchical, and that now there's been a real shift, and collaborative cultures are the cultures that are the most efficient, the most productive, deliver the best results. It's interesting to kind of see that shift. So I think that will force a different way of design.
The innovation typically comes from the bottom up today, and that's a total upside down from 1980s backward, where it was all kind of managed from above. Yep. Probably should be, but I'm not. Yeah, is that Murray Hill here in Manhattan?
No,
Ah, okay.
Wow.
I know there's a whole interesting theory about how so many pockets of kind of innovation that went up the East Coast, you know, this Boston down to New Jersey belt, could have been the Silicon Valley, but because of internal control over communication and stuff like that, never allowed the free knowledge sharing that the Valley allowed, so the Valley surpassed. I do think we're in a transitional age, very much so. although in some senses, every age is transitional. where will we be in 50 years' time? If I knew where technology was, we'd have a better idea. I think there's also something about the way in which we associate with each other that might evolve, and it's really hard to know what that is and what that means. You know, we've had biologically determined relationships, you know, the nuclear family being the most obvious. And that's determined many things about where we got to today, but I think that's broken down. Something else is probably happening, but we don't know what that is yet. I think being together is very, very important. I don't think you can kind of.
That's the bus.
I thought it meant I was out of time. I mean, this is a very interesting conversation, and it's one that's going through a lot of people's minds right now. Personally, I think people need to be together to collaborate and to innovate. I think they stimulate each other, and I think that's the downside of working at home. And there's a lot of you know, domestic commitment reasons why people need flexibility to do that. You know, particularly mothers, you know, with rearing children or fathers, sure. But that's a tertiary condition in many ways. It's not central to. That's true. You could argue that business has become, you know, progressively irresponsible over the last 300 years because little kids could be in the place of, or in the realm of the place of work back then. I don't know. It's a challenge.
Yeah, I mean, Jay, actually, one of the experiments Jay had was to do that, was to let people work from home. And it was one of the few things that he did that actually didn't work. For that very reason, I think that there's a sense of community. I mean, I think the interesting thing about these new workspaces that are popping up is that you can go in there for a day or you can sign up for a month. So there's this ability to be part of a community without being there all the time. I read that and I thought, I think it was probably the right call. I'm sure it caused all kinds of problems and issues, but. Yes, right, yeah, but it,
yeah, and it's not just about business. Like I was trying to suggest earlier, I think we need people around us. And we need to create our own new families. We need to be open to the fact that that's a positive social thing. You know, there's so many things that have broken down the connections between people over the last sort of century. It really is a time that people woke up and saw that there's a positive challenge there to kind of, you know, make your new tribes.
I think they actually like being together too. And that's been my experience.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, just my, so they go to Starbucks and work out of Starbucks because it's about being around other people. I mean, the idea from Grind came from the fact that every Starbucks, I couldn't, you know, sit down for 5 minutes when I was wandering around waiting to set my new company up because there was nowhere to go. I think people like to have somewhere to go and they think they like to be part of a family. And for me on the Yahoo thing, just as, you know, someone who's kind of run a couple of organizations, I was thinking, yeah, I kind of get, I think people were choosing not to be part of Yahoo, not just to be at home. And that's a different choice.
Yeah.
And, you know, so their commitment to making this thing successful, whatever this thing is, I think they have to make a choice about whether they want to be there or not on some level.
I mean, we're not just, I don't think anyone is just stimulated by the work we do. We're really not. We're stimulated by the people, even more than the actual work we do. And it's the friction in a good and bad way that goes on in an office that actually kind of, to a large extent, drives us to do and enjoy doing the things we're doing because we're interacting. It's actually sort of social and work, and it's playing a role in terms of reinforcing our self-image in the world. There's so many positive things I think about working with people. Sorry, there have been some people putting up their hands, and then we don't see them so easily. I'll go you first. When it came to people's private space, they could just go crazy. And that was seen as being, you know, a very positive thing for that company. I'm afraid the very back first, because she was... yep, you, yeah, sorry. I really couldn't pretend to be an expert in that. We kind of tend to follow where the experts in our client organizations are kind of going. And a lot of that, you know, relates to how reliable technology is in certain areas and for broad use across the workplace. So I have to admit to being kind of an amateur in that area. Yes. Yeah. It's actually... we'd love to. very interestingly on that same sort of subject, because what we're doing is there's no rocket science around this. It's actually all about just connecting people with what they want to do and making sure the environment helps them, you know, become who they want to be and connect with the people and processes and institutions that they want to connect with. one of the early workplace kind of projects, which was very similar to Shy Day, big warehouse conversion for an ad agency down in Orange County, a head of a fashion school happened to see this space be taken around it by a real estate agent. And they called us up and they said, we want our school to be like that. They were looking at an office And they're saying, we want our school to be like that because it was so much more fun. And they could immediately connect with a variety of opportunities. And they were like, oh, we could do this in that space, and we could do this in that space. And you know, suddenly the environment doesn't need to be monolithic. It doesn't need to be a kind of a one simple solution to what really is very complex, you know, the way people work and think and live together. So that was great. That got us into education to the extent that quite a large proportion of our work now is education. And the challenge in the education thing is different, but it's the same. It's both different and the same. What we do with classrooms is not necessarily a leap forward. What we do with the space outside classrooms is now completely different. We think about the circulation movement space of these schools as being opportunities for a much richer environment that can support a much bigger range of opportunities. And sometimes those things are incredibly simple. They're about, you know, putting a couple of benches in a slightly widened corridor at a certain moment in that corridor, so that because you know that the flow is going to allow people to hang out there, and it, you know, creates positive space out of negative space. Sorry, you first. Yeah. Yeah. Well, funny enough, on that subject, when we were working with Rose on JWT, I'm sure you remember this, we came to this kind of perfect diagram about how every group needed to relate to every other group, and they all had short, distances of connectivity, which would seem to be, you know, this is how you design a perfect organism, and then Rose suddenly said, oh my God, no one's going to move. And it was great. It was like, damn, that's so true. Anyway, subsequently, I don't know if you know this, there's now a concept out there in academia called planned inconvenience. And so Rose's solution was, okay, so the production department, which everyone goes to, is right in the middle. Let's move it right to the perimeter on the top floor. So everyone now has to go up to the top of the building when they want to go to the production studio. And we did that, and I think it worked.
No, it definitely worked.
So that's called planned inconvenience. And
the staircase. I mean, I love that staircase in that financial building. I want that staircase. But but we also put a huge staircase in the building, which cost a lot of money. But it made all the difference, because people stopped using the elevators and started using the staircase. And we actually put chairs and things on the stairs as people were going up, so you could just kind of sit and hang out there.
And the stairs are seen as, that's part of the use of the staircase. It's a super positive thing, also from a health point of view. That's part of moving around or having a range of different ergonomic kind of opportunities for sitting and standing at work, you know, higher tables, lower tables, and different types of seats and things. I remember once there was a lovely story about someone was asking a ballerina about posture. She said posture is kind of completely irrelevant to kind of physical health. Good posture doesn't get you anywhere. She said, look at a cat. Cats don't have good posture, but they never have back problems. Why do they never have back problems? Because they flop all over the place. They never stay too long in one situation, and as a result, they never have a problem. It's really interesting. And we're really the same as cats.
One more question, then we'll get up and stretch.
Definitely on the paperless office side. I mean, even our own office now, we've been selling filing cabinets for a while. It's just becoming less and less. Everything's starting to be electronically filed and mostly electronically received and sent. So yeah, I think paperless office 5 years, it's going to be reality for an awful lot of businesses. I'm not quite sure about the cocoon floating in space. I think the people, it's all part of people like a variety of opportunities. They like to be not always on the same level. They like to be up on perches. They like to be underneath things. They like to, no, like cats.
Well, I'm going to work on a different floor of Cooper-Hewitt tomorrow. You've been